The James Street Spicetown Circuit proudly presents the Palm Sunday Youth Rally on March 24th from 4 p.m. Prepare to be inspired, empowered, and filled with the triumphant spirit of Jesus. We're taking the theme even further this year, triumphant with Jesus, fighting like champions. This is a rallying cry for the warriors of faith. Discover how to fight life's battles with strength and courage. Big or small, this is a celebration. Hear incredible stories from young champions facing adversity and emerging victorious through unwavering faith in Jesus. Worship like never before. Our live band and praise team will lead a heart-pounding, soul-stirring celebration of Jesus' triumph. Come on, lift your voices, raise your hands, and let His Spirit fill this place. This Palm Sunday Youth Rally will be epic. Invite your friends, your family, and neighbors. Let's get this celebration echoing far beyond these walls. Save the date, mark your calendars, and prepare for the Palm Sunday Youth Rally. Triumphant with Jesus, fighting like champions. Rise, conquer, and triumph with Jesus Christ. See you there.
Let us pray. Man of sorrow, what a name. Hallelujah, what a Savior. Father God, you are our Savior, our protector, advisor, friend, and our King. You are our strength, especially in our weakest moments. Abba Father, we exist because you live. Your love for us, your children, is unconditional. Your love is truly matchless. Most forgiving God, Your love for us overlooks all the many ways we disappoint you daily. You died for us who have betrayed your love. You died for us who refuse to use our God-given talents for development and growth of your kingdom. You took the shame for us who are guilty of valuing our jobs, homes, families, and other earthly treasures more than we value our relationship with you. Father, remind us daily that you are the giver of these things and you have the ability to take them away. Help us, dear God, to use all these blessings to glorify your name and your kingdom. Lord, you died for us who are refusing to fulfill our true purpose. Help us to focus more on your instructions as they are presented in your spoken and written word, song, or other means of ministry. Even as we meditate at this moment, remove any distractions which will prevent us from reflecting on our shortcomings. Gracious God, create in us a new heart so that we will love our brothers and sisters despite how hard it may be at times. Guide our words, thoughts, actions, so that we may not cause others to stumble, but they may see your love shining through us. Lord, forgive us for doubting your ability to open doors. Help us to be patient and persevere as we await your intervention into our lives, because your word says, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future." Father God, help us to focus more on you, because only then that we will be able to follow the light and path you have in store for us. Father, we just want to glorify your name as you shower us with endless blessings daily. We also thank you for the many hard lessons which we learn daily, especially the ones which we find it hard to surrender fully to you. Lord, help us to look to you and lay aside our burdens at your throne, because you are the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. Amen.
The Bible lesson is taken from Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 to 2, the example of Jesus. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and the sin that clings so closely, and let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and the perfecter of our faith, who, for the sake of the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, disregarding its shame, and has taken his seat at the right hand of the throne of God. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Brothers and sisters, as we reflect tonight, I invite us to reflect under the title, Persevering in the Faith Race. As we reflect under the passage that was read in Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. Let us go to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you, O God, for your love. We thank you, O God, that because of your love, you gave your only begotten Son. So that, O God, you can make a way for us back to you. And you didn't just make a way, but you have also given us your Holy Spirit to enable us to come back to you and to remain with you and to abide with you. So God, as we reflect upon your word and as we reflect upon this race that we have been called to run, help us, O God, to reflect, O God, and open our hearts and our minds to your word so that your word can take root in our lives and bear good fruit to the glory of your name. Amen. Brothers and sisters, there is always the temptation to give up on something or to start believing that we have made the wrong choice when the going gets tough, when life brings one inconvenience after another, or when life, for some reason, was comfortable and fairly settled, and then I decided to follow Jesus, and now it is just one trial after the other. Or when I have been brought out of my comfort zone, I have been challenged to abandon self-preservation because I have chosen obedience to Jesus. Or I am going along my merry way, minding my own business. And then because out of obedience to Jesus, I decide to speak truth in love to a neighbor, to stand up for what is right. And then the consequences and repercussions of such will cause us sometimes to ask, shouldn't I have just kept my mouth shut? Or sometimes it may be my relationship with another is going smoothly, we are on good terms. And then God convicts us about something that we are keeping secret from him or her. And you're wrestling with God because if you go and you share this secret, you know it is going to upset the rhythm of the relationship right now. Or it may be I'm doing schoolwork. I got a good grade from secondary school, UWI. And something tells me to count up the grades. And I realize that the lecturer made a wrong count. And I'm actually supposed to get less. And letting the lecturer know will take me from the 60s to the 50s. But out of obedience to Christ, I let the lecturer know. And brothers and sisters, I can go on and on and on about the inconveniences, the trials of living this Christian life. And I'm sure, brothers and sisters, you will agree with me that the Christian life is a life to be lived by faith, but we must persevere in this faith. You see, brothers and sisters, the community of faith that the writer of Hebrews writes to was going through similar struggles. They were experiencing persecution, hardship, trials because of their faith in Christ. As a result, they began doubting if they made the right decision to follow Jesus. They were Jewish Christians, so they were contemplating abandoning the Christian faith and going back to Judaism. This is seen by exhortations given at different places in the book, such as Hebrews 3, 12 to 14. He says, "Take care, brothers and sisters, that none of you may have an evil, unbelieving heart that turns away from the living God, but exhort one another every day. For we have become partners of Christ, if Only we hold our first confidence firm to the end. Hebrews 6:4-6 reminds us, he says, "For it is impossible to restore again to repentance those who have once been enlightened and have tasted the heavenly gift and have shared in the Holy Spirit and have tasted the goodness of the word of God and the powers of the age to come, and then have fallen away." And we want each one of you to show the same diligence so as to realize the full assurance of hope to the very end, so that you may not become sluggish, but imitators of those who through faith and patience inherit the promises. Hebrews 10:32-36 says, "But recall those earlier days when after you had been enlightened, you endured a hard struggle with suffering, sometimes being publicly exposed to abuse and persecution, and sometimes being partners with those who so treated you. For you had compassion for those who were in prison, and you cheerfully accepted the plundering of your possessions, knowing that you yourselves possess something better and more lasting. Do not therefore abandon the confidence of yours. It brings a great reward, for you need endurance, so that when you have done the will of God, you may receive what was promised." So brothers and sisters, the writer, after warning them, after pleading with them, reminding them throughout the book that Jesus is superior to angels and prophets and priests and sacrifices, and as much as they are facing trials, Jesus is really the only way to God. He uses Hebrews 11 to explain what faith is, shows that it is impossible to live a life pleasing to God without living it by faith, and gave many past examples of those who lived by faith to the very end. He therefore exhorts the believers to stick with Jesus, press forward with Jesus no matter what. He challenges them to persevere in faith, believing it or not, that they are running the right race. The writer is trying to make abundantly clear that this Christian life, if we are truly to follow Christ in this world, it will not be easy. It is a marathon faith race. It is a multi-terrain race that goes from rough and steep to smooth and flat. It is not a race to see who comes first, but all that is required is that we stay in the race, abiding by its rules, and finish the race, where death is the finishing line. So not those who stop halfway or give up, but those who finish, because that's why Hebrews 10:37-38 says, "For yet in a very little while, the one who is coming will come and will not delay. But my righteous one who live by faith, my soul takes no pleasure in anyone who shrinks back." My brothers and sisters, hence why the writer calls to all readers that there's a necessity, not an option, a necessity for perseverance in this faith race. Perseverance, which also means patience and endurance, no matter what. So in chapter 12, the writer gives counsel of how we can run this race in such a way that we can finish the race. The writer offers counsel of how we can run this race with perseverance. The first thing the writer suggests is that we run this race with perseverance by looking around for the faith winners. Hear what verse 1 in the first part says. "Therefore, since you are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses," meaning this verse connects us with back to chapter 11, where the writer, after defining faith, went on to give an example, or almost like a hall of fame, of all the persons throughout Israel's history who ran this faith race and ran it well. So, and where they persevered in faith to the very end. My brothers and sisters, in any race, encouragement helps to fuel endurance. Being surrounded by the right persons, examples, and community can be a source of encouragement, especially when running gets tough. So, for example, we are in the season of school sports. I believe some of us may have been following the different races. And I'm sure we can all agree that when you are running a race and you are tired or feel like you can't make it, that this is the time when a rush of adrenaline that comes from cheers or from seeing your teammates running so well and really fighting for the win, or the great efforts and lengths that you see your teachers are going to help the athletes to ensure that they win, and or it could be from the long haul of fame that comes from your school who have dominated track and field. All of these things can be a major booster that can help us to overcome fatigue or the discomfort of an injury. My brothers and sisters, this is an experience or reminder that if these things are great sources of motivation to press on, to push through, to finish well, even if physically or mentally we may feel like giving up, we may feel like stop fighting or not to finish the race. But my brothers and sisters, to have the right examples, to have the right support can be a great source of motivation. And so similarly in this faith race, as the writer exhorts the believers, he's saying to them, look around. Because these were Jewish Christians. And he says, look at your history. Let me point you to some people who ran this faith race, who faced trials as well, but they endured by having faith in God and holding on to the promises of God. And right examples don't only motivate, but the right examples helps us to keep the right standard. You see, the persons mentioned in Hebrews 11 were not foreign to the readers. In fact, that is the very reason why the writer uses them, because they would be familiar with these Jewish heroes. However, the people never looked at their life or the life of these persons necessarily as an example of faith. But they probably looked at them as just great figures in the history of Israel, whose life and example is so great that it's probably out of their reach. But the writer shows them that all these men and women were ordinary human beings who faced hardships, trials, and uncertainties that they are going through. But what made the difference for them from other persons in their history was that they held on to their faith in God to the very end. They held on to the promises of God, and as a result of that, the writer was deliberate in showing that all of them were rewarded as a result of living by faith. My brothers and sisters, the sad truth is that in Christianity, there are so many bad examples. There are so many who profess Christianity, but are not living by faith and are not living according to the true faith in Jesus Christ. There are false prophets in the Caribbean. Our slavery history coming out of Europe gives so many poor and bad examples of Christianity. We have a church today where many are living the Christian life rather than being led by the Spirit or being led by the flesh. That's why Mahatma Gandhi had to say, I like your Christ, but not your Christians. But my brothers and sisters, I want to encourage us and assure us that although there are so many negative examples, there still is a great deal of men and women of God out there, men and women of God around us, who are seeking to live an authentic life of faith in Jesus Christ. And so if we want the right motivation, we have to search out and ask God for discernment to find the right examples and to look back in the history through the word and even around us presently to associate with the right examples and persons who are seeking to live by faith in Jesus and seeking to be faithful to the very end. But not only must we look around, But the writer also suggests that we must look at ourselves constantly. So in the second part of chapter, verse 1, after saying, therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, he says, let us also lay aside every weight and the sin that clings so closely. And let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us. You see, if we connect this with the previous verse, it is saying that since we have so many examples to motivate us and God does reward a life by faith in him, then let's go for it. But in this way, in order to run this race with perseverance, the writer is saying, we also need to keep constant watch over ourselves. We must keep watch because there are unnecessary baggage that we may be carrying that can weigh us down on this race. Or we can be disqualified from the race if we don't run by the rules. See, brothers and sisters, there are things in our lives and if left unchecked, can cause the race to feel like an obstacle or burden. Feel like I am running under compulsion. Feel like I'm getting tired very easily. And cause others to run at a faster pace than we ever run. And this race, brothers and sisters, takes intentionality, focus, and training. And so therefore, the writer is suggesting that we cannot allow anything to hinder us. Hence why the writer says in the verse, let us lay aside, mean put aside, renounce every weight. Brothers and sisters, a weight is not determined here simply by what is good and bad. But it is about anything, everything that hinders our progress in following Christ. Anything that is a burden or strain to walk in faithfully with Christ. So for example, we can have the weight of doubt, where we can have some faith, but mixed with that faith, there's a great level of unbelief that just like Peter can sink us. We can have the weight of fear that when the circumstances and the many terrors that happen in our world grips our human heart, and even things sometimes like COVID-19, we can easily abandon the faith race. But God wants us to fear him and turn away from evil. But what the devil tries to do is to get us to fear evil and turn from trusting in God. There's the weight of sluggishness, where we lose zeal, we lose heart, we give God a half heart, we are drained of our drive in this Christian race. We are not giving it our all, we are going through the motion, because we have doubts about if the race is really worth it. There's also the weight of preoccupation with self. Self becomes the center of one's attention, but self, brothers and sisters, can never satisfy our soul. There are weights also of divided focus, discontentment, weights where we say to ourselves, I'll never change, weights where we of our low self-esteem. And then the writer also speaks about the sin that clings so closely. Other versions talks about besetting sins. Sins that we continually struggle with. Sins that, and these may be different for each of us according to, what tempts us and what really we struggle with. May not be the same for everyone. But sins that can easily trap us and trip us and disqualify us from the race. And so things like gossiping, lying, losing our temper, and lust. And so how do we lay aside these things? And brothers and sisters, I want to suggest that we first have to humble ourselves. We have to pray. We have to seek to confess, agree with God that these things are wrong in our lives and turn from them. And lastly, as we turn from these things, the writer exhorts us in verse 2 to look to Jesus. It says, look into Jesus, the founder and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. You see, brothers and sisters, while there are others who can motivate us on this faith race, there is no greater motivation, guidance, and hope that can be found. And there's no greater that can be found in no other but Jesus. That's why the writer says he is the author and perfecter of our faith. To put it differently, he is the originator and finisher. He is the Alpha and the Omega. There's no one above him and there's no one after him. So Jesus, my brothers and sisters, endured far more than any other hero of the faith. Philippians 2 reminds us that he emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness, and being found in human form. He humbled himself and became obedient, even to the point of death, even death on a cross. My brothers and sisters, the verse also tells us that Jesus was motivated by the joy that was set before him, the promises of his Father. And we are too, my brothers and sisters, must just like Jesus, that rather than focus on the trials and the troubles that come with this race, but rather we must be encouraged by the promises of God. Because the one who has promised us is faithful. Jesus also endured until the very end. His last cry on the cross was, "It is finished." So, Father, I commend my spirit. See, brothers and sisters, not only is his example the greatest source of motivation, but because of his faithfulness, he has opened doors for us. Because he finished his faith race, he has become our source of salvation. He has become our righteousness, our wisdom, our source of eternal life. Because he finished his faith race, we have now a living hope beyond this life. We can now look forward to overcoming death. And we can now look forward to treasure in heaven. That's why the songwriter could say, "Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full into his wonderful face. And the things of this earth will grow strangely dim in light of his glory and grace." My brothers and sisters, I don't know where you may be tonight on this Christian race. Maybe you may be on the fence. Or you're just starting. Or you have started but you're slipping back. Or you're stumbling forward. Or you're moving forward steadily. Wherever you may be, I want to encourage you tonight to never abandon this faith race. It is the best race we can ever run in this life. And God gives us Jesus to help us run this race. But please remember that this race is a marathon. It has multi-terrain. And therefore, it's a race that must be run by faith. And we must persevere in that faith. And we can only do so by finding encouragement, the right kind of encouragement from the faith winners, those of the past and those who are around us right now. We need to be constantly keeping check of our lives. And most of all, we need to keep our eyes fixed on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. A songwriter pens these words, and I hope it encourages you as much as it encourages me. Praise is rising. Eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring. Hearts are yearning for you. We long for you. Because when we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away. Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us. Worthy of all our praises. Hosanna, Hosanna. Come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Through it all.
And pain.
Through it all,
sunshine and rain.
Through it all,
oh,
I've learned to depend upon
you. So now I thank God for every mountain. And I thank him for the valleys. And I thank him for those storms already brought me through. If I never had a problem, I never knew that God could solve them. I would never know what faith in his word could do. Now I tell you, if you it all, God never failed me. Trust in Jesus.
I've learned to trust in God.
Through the hard times.
Through it all.
Through the dark days. Now. Through it all.
Through it all.
God never failed me. No, no, no. Oh, yeah.
To depend upon his word.
Sing again, sing it again. Let me tell you this.
Let us go to God in prayer. So, Heavenly Father, we thank you, O God, once again for granting us the privilege to run this faith race. O God, we know, O God, that it is not an easy road. As Jesus describes it as the narrow way. But, O God, even as it is not easy, we don't look to ourselves for the strength and the guidance, but we look to you, knowing that for man it is impossible, but with God all things are possible. So, God, I pray that you will guide us and touch us in tonight, O God, that, O God, that you will so encourage us. That, O God, you will so remind us, assure us that this is the race that we ought to be running. That even though the trials and tribulations may sometimes bring a bit of darkness over the race and cause us to cause doubt and sometimes cause us to think if we have made the right choice. But, O God, through the power of your Holy Spirit, encourage us and remind us that we are on the right track. And so, God, help us wherever we are to either it is to encourage us to come back on this race or to continue. But strengthen us, O God. Guide us. Help us, O God, to seek inspiration from each other as we imitate Christ. Help us, O God, to keep watch over our lives. And help us, O God, to keep our eyes fixed on Jesus Christ. This I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Please receive the benediction. And so now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest, remain, and abide with us all, now and forevermore. Amen.
The James Street Spicetown Circuit proudly presents the Palm Sunday Youth Rally on March 24th from 4 p.m. Prepare to be inspired, empowered, and filled with the triumphant spirit of Jesus. We're taking the theme even further this year, triumphant with Jesus, fighting like champions. This is a rallying cry for the warriors of faith. Discover how to fight life's battles with strength and courage. Big or small, this is a celebration. Hear incredible stories from young champions facing adversity and emerging victorious through unwavering faith in Jesus. Worship like never before. Our live band and praise team will lead a heart-pounding, soul-stirring celebration of Jesus' triumph. Come on, lift your voices, raise your hands, and let His Spirit fill this place. This Palm Sunday Youth Rally will be epic. Invite your friends, your family, and neighbors. Let's get this celebration echoing far beyond these walls. Save the date, mark your calendars, and prepare for the Palm Sunday Youth Rally. Triumphant with Jesus, fighting like champions. Rise, conquer, and triumph with Jesus Christ. See you there.
Thank you for being a part of our daily devotion. We trust it has been a blessing to you. Now together, let us hold fast to His word, and may it dwell in all of us richly.